This video is brought to you by Lark. There's concerns that homes with solar panels are reducing their utility bills at the expense of their neighbors without solar panels.
When customers install solar, they are generally shifting costs onto people who are poorer than they are.
The phenomenon is referred to as cost shifting. The idea that credits utilities pay solar homes for the energy they produce ultimately results in higher bills for customers without panels.
Got this $4 billion a year cost shift.
These solar rooftop owners are being overpaid.
In this case, everybody needs to pay their fair share of the grid.
This has had major implications on public policy, for better or worse.
Right now in San Diego, a solar system will pay for itself in about 6 years. Under the new net metering rules, we're kicking that to 10 years or further.
So is there any truth to the idea that the solar haves are making things worse for the solar have-nots? Who really benefits from residential solar? And how can we invest in renewables while keeping things fair? And is the solar cost shift real? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This topic is one that's been boiling around in the back of my mind for a while now, but it's bubbled up to the surface with some recent commentary that I've been seeing online. It shouldn't be a surprise to anyone that I'm a fan of solar technology for homes, communities, and the grid. I have it on my current house, and I'm installing it on my new one. So the cost shift has really been nagging at me. The more we dug into it for this video, the more I felt like we were peeling an onion. And there's nuance to this, which does not always go over well on social media, so let me just be a little bit spicy. The solar cost shift is largely a myth that has the feeling of truth, which is why it has such legs. But why? And who started it? Within the US, this tension has intensified as solar has become more common. Over the years, the argument that residential rooftop panels worsen the financial burden of everybody else has cropped up again and again. The thing is, the issue is far more tangled or maybe interconnected than you might believe. And there's a lot more to it than just math. So let's be clear, the installation of residential solar in the US is inequitable because incomes in the US are inequitable. Similar to a lot of tech, solar adoption tends to reflect existing disparities. It skews towards, but isn't limited to, high-income white households. Now this isn't the full story, and we'll get into that a little bit later, but it makes sense to question how the concentration of solar among the wealthy affects everybody else. The fundamental conflict of the cost shift, though, comes down to the idea that by using solar panels but remaining tied to the grid, people can get away without paying their fair share for maintenance of the grid. Consequently, these costs are then shifted to those without panels. The overall narrative is that as things stand in the world of residential solar, the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. As the typically wealthier households with panels enjoy the benefits of generating their own power, utilities lose revenue and the common folk are left to pick up the bill. So following this logic, does it really hurt the grid and by extension the pockets of your neighbors to go solar? Now before we get into that, I'd like to share something else that definitely won't hurt and can actually help you today, and that's from today's sponsor, Lark. 186 million Americans are drinking water with lead that exceeds the levels recommended by the EPA, which drives a lot of people to purchase more bottled water, which has a host of problems around single-use plastic bottles. Another topic I've talked a lot about. I prefer to filter our slightly odd-tasting tap water. The Lark Bottle Filtered uses nano-zero filter technology to remove lead, heavy metals, chlorine, and other particulates in your water. It's an incredibly solid and well-built bottle that can keep water cold for 24 hours. When we go on road trips, we like to take bottled water with us, but with this, we can feel confident in refilling it wherever we go. And this little filter can clean up to 40 gallons of water, which is about 2 months of use. It's kind of incredible, and really does make for great-tasting water. Use the link in the description below to order yourself a Lark Bottled Filtered and start enjoying fresh, pure water today. Thanks again to Lark and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to the question, does residential solar hurt the grid, and by extension the pockets of your neighbors, to go solar?
Everyone uses the electric grid. Everyone should pay their fair share.
That's a line from an ad run by the Affordable Clean Energy for All Coalition, which identifies itself as organizations representing renewable energy companies, electric customers, seniors, small businesses, faith-based organizations, other diverse community groups, and the state's three investor-owned utilities. I'll be getting to that coalition more in a bit, but it's a reasonable-sounding position, right?
Another way to look at it is if you own a car, it's like paying taxes for the roads. If you don't pay your taxes, pretty soon the roads are gonna have potholes in them and they're gonna crumble. So everybody needs to pay their fair share of the roads. In this case, everybody needs to pay their fair share of the grid.
But it's vague. What's a fair share and who decides this? At a basic level, the problem of the cost shift isn't technological or even solar specific. It's a regulatory and economic conflict that stems from the complicated puzzle of designing fair electricity rates. The rapid influx of renewables onto the grid is creating the necessity for utilities to adapt.
One critical reason for changing the incentives for solar panel owners who aren't paying a bill, they are not supporting the energy infrastructure.
Suddenly, customers can now become prosumers, or producers and consumers, by installing solar panels on the roof. As a result, the grid is decentralizing, and prosumers have their own role to play in the distribution of energy. Managing a flow of electricity that can travel from the grid to customer and vice versa requires modernization of infrastructure. And modernization of infrastructure requires money. On top of this, utilities always have to budget for what are known as fixed costs. Now, these are expenses that don't change regardless of sales, the things that quite literally keep the lights on. For example, the network infrastructure itself and the maintenance of power lines. Essentially, utilities advocate for the principle of fixed charges should reflect fixed costs. That's the core concept of the cost shift concept. Under the rate structure of net metering, as it's known here in the US, or net energy metering, NEM, solar households receive a credit on their bill in exchange for the energy that they generate but don't use. The net in net metering refers to the value you get when you subtract the electricity production from electricity consumption. Utilities argue that within this system, solar households represent a cost in the sense that the rates that they pay, or more specifically, the rates that they allegedly don't pay, makes them more expensive to serve relative to other customers. That missing revenue must be made up, and so utilities have to raise costs for everybody else.
Those who don't have solar are paying extra, hundreds of dollars extra a year in their electricity bills to cover the subsidies that flow to mostly wealthy Californians who are able to afford homes and afford solar panels.
Now here's how it's laid out by a 2018 U.S. Department of Energy study. The benefit of bill savings to the customer is the same as lost revenue to the utility. If and how that lost revenue is captured through different rate designs can affect both participating, i.e. with PV systems, and non-participating, without PV system customers. That's definitely a frustrating thought. Why should one group have to pay more because another group is paying less? Shouldn't everyone that's connected to the grid contribute to its upkeep? Well, taken together with the fact that households with rooftop solar are often wealthier, it's easy to see how net metering and rooftop solar itself has been a point of contention for so long. These are all valid gripes to have, but positioning solar households as a cost or loss that forces the hand of utilities relies on ideological assumptions. And the biggest one? The customers are under obligation to pay for a service regardless of if they use it. In this case, the electricity provided by the grid. Now, the truth is, whether you offset your costs by installing solar panels or just by turning off the lights more often, you can potentially cause a cost shift. That's because any reduction in electricity use for any reason can leave a utility making less money than expected. If I buy an energy-efficient electric dryer, refrigerator, or furnace, does that jack up the cost of electricity for my neighbors? If I drive my car less, does it raise the cost of gas for everybody else? In fact, in a 2017 study by Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, researcher Galen Barbose argues that energy efficiency programs have had a much bigger effect on electricity sales than distributed solar. He points out that in 2015, initiatives like appliance efficiency standards knocked down US retail electricity sales by about 14%. In comparison, all the net metered solar installed throughout that year only amounted to a 0.4% reduction in sales. However, utilities insist that grid use and electricity use are separate things. That is, simply by being connected to the grid, customers' bills should reflect both their electricity consumption and the utility's cost of doing business. You have to remember, though, that investor-owned utilities are businesses, and it isn't the inherent responsibility of consumers to ensure that a business meets its revenue targets, nor should it be. Just take it from Carl Robago, who's acted as both a public utility commissioner and a utility executive. In other words, he's someone who has knowledge from both sides. In a 2016 article on net metering, he writes, "The utility argument is implicitly that it had counted on collecting an average amount of its fixed costs from all customers through its volumetric energy sales. So customers that use less than they had, or less than the utility assumed, are not paying their fair share and avoiding responsibility for system costs. Deviations from average or assumed consumption levels do not give rise to a cost for which the utility is entitled to recovery, especially not from a customer who failed to meet the utility's expected level of consumption." You can see a reflection of this fixed cost on my own electric bill. Even though I might produce all of the electricity I use in a given month, I still have a flat customer charge of $10. Another member of my team has a basic service, not including usage fee, of $17.33. Now, when you look at the big picture, though, this logic doesn't fly with any other commodity. As pointed out in a 2018 article co-authored by Rubago, we don't pay cover charges at coffee shops. A similar metaphor has also been discussed by Ralph Kavanaugh, energy co-director and attorney for the National Resources Defense Council. Someone explained to me that a minimum bill is like a two-drink minimum in a bar, while a fixed charge is like a cover charge. Everyone in a rate class subject to a fixed charge pays it, regardless of consumption. The resulting revenues are used to reduce charges per kilowatt hour, which also reduces customers' reward for saving electricity. But unlike a fancy drink, energy is a necessity to life. It's not an indulgence, though some are more fast and loose with their usage. And the ones who conserve the most are subject to the highest rates when fixed costs are conflated with fixed charges. On that point, John Howitt, senior energy analyst of the National Consumer Law Center, argues, fixed charges create an intra-class cost shift from high-volume to low-volume customers. On average, low-income households, the elderly, and households of color use less energy than their counterparts in their rate class. Bigger fixed charges reduce incentives for energy efficiency and customer control over their bills. For example, Madison Gas and Electric in Wisconsin proposed going from a fixed charge of $10.44 a month to $19 a month and a reduction in the volumetric charge. That would result in a 5.5% increase in costs for low-use customers, while costs for high-end customers would drop 2.7%. See? Accommodating for utilities and keeping things fair for customers at the same time is just so easy. Or not so much. Even when rates are unbearable, the vast majority of customers in the US can't just take their business elsewhere. There's also the possibility of going off-grid completely, but it's a bigger investment than installing solar panels alone, which makes it even less accessible. It also makes matters worse for everyone by reducing the amount of energy available and, ironically, spreading these darned fixed costs among a smaller customer base, also known as the exact phenomenon we're trying to avoid. I can use myself as a personal example here. You have to size your solar PV system to the lowest common denominator. So for me, I'd have to account for the performance drops during the months of December and January. And by sizing my system so large to accommodate for that, it's going to produce a ridiculous amount of energy in the middle of May or June. Energy I can't use. If I'm off-grid, that's an absurd amount of wasted energy potential that others in my community could have benefited from. Incentivizing prosumers to stay grid-connected is good for everyone. Everyone, including power companies. Enel, the second largest utility in the world, is aware of this. It considers the number of prosumers connected to its grids an achievement. And in November 2021, the company celebrated reaching the milestone of over 1 million prosumers on its networks across the globe. That represents a collective installed capacity of about 57 gigawatts. Over in Australia, which has the highest amount of solar PV per capita in the world, about 29% of the population already has solar panels on their home or is considering getting it, according to a national survey conducted earlier this year. Inequities in solar adoption are still an issue, but rooftop solar specifically is helping to drive down demand. Less demand means lower prices and fewer emissions, which benefits everybody. Just this March, a record average output of 2,962 megawatts from rooftop solar contributed to the lowest Q1 operational demand in the national energy market since 2005. And that's according to the Australian Energy Market Operator. It's important to note here, though, that the IEA estimates that based on installed solar capacity, the total theoretical PV penetration in Australia is 15.7% as of 2022, where the previous survey I mentioned includes people considering getting solar. In other countries, this level is even higher. Spain, Greece, and Chile sit atop the chart with values of 19.1%, 17.5%, and 17% respectively. Meanwhile, although the US solar market is rapidly growing, the nation is still significantly less involved with solar compared with other countries. Its total theoretical PV penetration is about 5.1%, and as described in a 2021 study by the U.S. National Renewable Energy Laboratory, or NREL, distributed solar on the whole is underused. More than 95% of the roof space that could accommodate solar is just sitting there with potential renewable energy ripe for the taking. But the vast majority of the U.S. solar generation is also limited to a few states, with California customers making up about 44% of the net metered market. If California alone were a country, its PV contribution would be 25%, according to NREL. And when you divvy up the country in terms of the independent system operators, or ISOs, that manage the regional portions of the grid, the California ISO solar generation capacity is the biggest by a huge wide margin. Solar accounted for about 18.7% of the California ISO's annual load in 2019. Second to California is New England's ISO, where I live, with solar at 4.3%. Now this leaves the rest of the country's ISOs in the dust. In 2019, solar generation shares everywhere else were at or below 2%. So why is this important? Because the potential impact of net metered solar on electricity prices doesn't even become relevant until you reach higher levels of penetration of roughly 10% and beyond. This is why the cost shifting argument is largely a myth. We're so far away from this possibly being an issue in most locations in the states. Even if you live in an area like California that's well over that threshold, the impact isn't as significant or as cut and dry as emotional ad campaigns want you to believe. As described in the 2017 study by Barbos mentioned earlier, for the vast majority of states and utilities, the effects of distributed solar on retail electricity prices will likely remain negligible for the foreseeable future. This means that the fear of cost shifting, legitimate or not, can't be extrapolated to the entirety of the US, at least not yet. By obscuring the regional context of cost shifting, setting aside the fact that it barely exists, it's easy to promote it as a pressing issue long before solar has even had a chance to establish a foothold. It's using it as a boogeyman argument. Mississippi, for example, is currently home to less than 1,000 net metered households. It also happens to have solar incentives that are among the stingiest in the country. And yet, back in February of 2022, when only 586 residential solar systems existed in the entire state, Mississippi Power argued that efforts to further incentivize solar would be financially shouldered by the non-participating customers. Sound familiar? Most people already have trouble trying to decipher their own bills. Mischaracterizing rooftop solar as the enemy of the poor exploits the complexity of rate making and regulation, and has serious repercussions. Recently, concerns about cost shifting have directly impacted California's public policies.
Big change coming for California, and it all comes down to how much residents are credited for the power they send back to the grid.
The state's restructured version of its net metering program came into effect in April, and a peek at NREL's winter 2023 update on USPV shows that prosumers, solar advocates, and environmentalist groups are not happy. They argue that with greatly reduced incentives, Californians will ultimately decide against going solar, and that pretty soon the market won't be feeling so hot.
By making it harder for everyday people to get rooftop solar, the grid's going to get more expensive for everybody. So they've just delivered a double whammy, not just to people who want solar, but to all ratepayers.
To make matters worse, decisions like these may actually be deepening existing inequalities. Solar adoption is starting to spread out more proportionally across income groups, slowly but surely. As the Berkeley Lab noted in a 2022 report, 22% of all 2021 adopters earn less than 80% of area median income. Another 21% were between 80 and 120% of their area median income. If newer solar adopters from these lower income groups don't receive the same savings and benefits as older adopters from higher income groups, that can effectively lock in inequities. So why then do investor-owned utilities rail so much against incentivizing rooftop solar? Because their main priority as a business is money. Distributed generation is emerging as competition in disrupting the natural monopoly. And as we've shown, both energy efficiency and rooftop solar directly threaten utilities' profits. This is repeated in plain language again and again over the years of research. But the costs and benefits of solar or any renewable generation are not purely numerical. Analysis that try to quantify the worth of rooftop solar, of course, rely on a variety of factors. Understanding why some are included and why some are downplayed or left out entirely means following the money. Hey, remember that coalition, Affordable Clean Energy for All? Well, that one included a bunch of community organizations and three investor-owned utilities. Well, it turns out those three, Pacific Gas and Electric, Southern California Electric, and San Diego Gas and Electric, donated a combined $1.7 million to the group in 2020. So whose best interests do you think they have at heart? Now, one thing is for certain, balancing the perspectives of utilities, ratepayers, and regulators when incentivizing rooftop solar is not a simple task. But the motivation behind propagating the myth of cost shifting is profit. You can believe what you'd like about utilities' entitlement to the money, or lack thereof, but buying into their misinformation doesn't help you as a consumer, your neighbors, or the planet. This is a confusing enough topic as it is, so let's keep it honest. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where I'll be discussing some of your feedback. Thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video, and thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.